2018 NEU ATL section conference. It's our last, so I'm sure, and I've heard in the debates already this morning, we'll make it a good one. And I'd like you also to welcome Kevin Courtney, Joint General Secretary, who's in the hall. Kevin, stand up, he's 6'7", so you will see him. And I want you all in the hall at 11:30, because Kevin's going to speak to you, and you'll all want to hear what he's going to say. So one of the great strengths of ATL and ATL Conference is that there's such a broad cross-section of the education professionals attending conference, and we learn so much from each other. And in our debates, which are rich and varied and interesting, we recognise just how closely we work together. I think the support staff motion just debated now was absolutely redolent of that notion that we are one education professional. We have different, complementary, equal roles within that education profession. And as a union is based on the collective, working together in solidarity. That is what we are doing at this conference. That is what we have done in ATL with the different sections. And that is what we will take forward into the National Education Union. So I'm going to talk about teachers tomorrow in my main speech, but I don't want, because that's the way the speech panned out. But in our hall today and throughout our conference, we have the different sections of evidence. So can you put your hands up, please, if you're an AAMI member? Welcome to conference. AAMI has done great work this year. Responding to members' needs, AAMI has published a booklet on building resilience, which takes its place amongst AAMI's suite of excellent publications designed to help leaders and aspiring leaders to lead more effectively. And the key thing with AAMI is ethical leadership, that the best leaders are the ones that inspire, support, train, develop all their staff. And if they do that well, then that's a successful place of work, because those staff do the same with the pupils, children and the young people that they educate. And that's been a key thing for AAMI. So AAMI's led this year on a code of leadership practice, and it's been launched this week at conference, designed to help leaders and teachers collaborate and work together to move their school or college onto a journey to effective leadership at all levels throughout the organisation. We know that these are tough times, but the best leaders in tough times take their staff with them and work with them to meet the challenges together. So welcome to all AAMI members. Can you put your hands up if you're working in the post-16 FE institution? Fantastic, welcome to conference. You're in really good hands this year, because Niamh, your president, is a post-16 professional. She knows the sector and its challenges, and she will really be talking about that in her speech. I just wanted to say something about a very effective campaign we've been running in FE, writing to MPs of all political parties and asking them to visit their local FE college and to talk to our members. And this is vital, because most MPs will not have been to an FE college and their children will not encounter FE, further education. So actually getting them into a college and actually seeing at first hand the fantastic work FE colleges do is really important. We've had 12 MPs so far going into FE colleges and talking to members and seeing classes and seeing what goes on there. Another 8 MPs have made appointments to do that. And several of those MPs, after going into college, have written to Anne Milton, the Skills Minister, and she's now very aware of the National Education Union and its issues about further education funding. If school funding is terrible, FE funding is execrable. And we have to really point that out and make it clear. And she's also very aware about the problems caused about the maths and English resits. And Barry Shearman, the MP for Huddersfield and the former chair of the Education Select Committee, has promised to apply for a House of Commons post-16 debate on post-16 funding. So welcome if you're an FE post-16, working in post-16, we want to hear from you. Now, we've already had support staff putting their hands up. We had a brilliant support staff motion. We're having further support staff motions in the debate. But now support staff membership in the National Education Union is standing at over 25,000 members. That's 3,000 up from the 1st of September 17. And many NUT reps and branches are enthusiastically accepting support staff into membership. And it's really making a difference, and they're seeing it making a difference. So at the village school in Brent, where the National Education Union was fighting a forced academisation, support staff membership in the school went up from 2 to 102 in the past 6 months. And some lessons have been learned. For example, if you want to take successful strike action in a special school, if you get the support staff out supporting you on the action, then the school will close because it can't carry on without support staff. Do we have any Durham TAs here? Well done, well done, well done. Your example, your solidarity, and you didn't get everything you want, but you got a lot more than you were going to be given, and that inspires us as well. How many people here are from the independent sector? Welcome to conference. The National Education Union now has over 30,000 members working within the independent sector, which covers a wide range of establishments, including high-need specialist SEND schools. And joining gives our membership in the independent sector strength in numbers, and it enables our independent school members to act collectively. And I'm proud to be able to report to you that the first trade union recognition agreement to be signed in the name of the National Education Union was led by ATL section members in the independent centre in no less a school than Charterhouse. Other recognition agreements since last year's conference include the Grammar School at Leeds, Mill Hill, Belmont, Grimsdale and the Mount International Schools in North London. And why does this matter? It matters because if you get recognition, then you can make effective changes for the membership. So in the Girls' Day School Trust, on a proposed new pay policy, the National Education Union is the sole recognised union on behalf of 3,500 staff, teachers and support staff in 24 independent schools run by the Girls' Day School Trust across the country. And as a progressive employer and as a consequence of the recognition agreement, the Trust has given the undertaking that the proposed policy will only be implemented by collective agreement with the National Education Union. And consultation and negotiation is ongoing. And our workplace representatives will be gathering in London on the 1st of May to determine our collective position. We also have conference members from Wales. Can you put your hands up? From Wales. Well done. And we know that in Wales now they're developing a new national bargaining structure for pay and conditions, and we will be hearing about that at our conference today. We've also got members from Scotland. We've got one member from Scotland. Hi, Alistair. And we've also got members from Northern Ireland. Can you put your hands up if you're from Northern Ireland? And I just want to say a little bit about Northern Ireland because I think it's extraordinary and remarkable, and I'm not sure we've recognised what our members in Northern Ireland have done enough. So since 2013, it's been ATL leading within Northern Ireland, where members in Northern Ireland have engaged in sustained non-cooperation with all aspects of key stage assessment, key stage 2 and 3 assessments, which were put in place that the members just haven't done them. And leading that action, that's now led the other teacher unions in Northern Ireland do the same, UTU and INTO, in sustained non-cooperation, not with assessing students, but with a bureaucratic, inflexible, unproductive system of assessment, which was taking up hours, and which our members led the way in saying, we're not doing it. We're just not doing it. So school by school, and this is the key thing about this action, members decide school by school what they are not going to do. We've got a checklist, but they decide in their work to rule and working to terms and conditions of employment. They're doing this in addition to the key stage, not doing the key stage assistance. School by school, members have worked out what they are not going to do. What they have decided is unproductive and unnecessary workloads. They are requiring principals to issue teachers with working time budgets. And since the 16th of January 2016, ATL members, now NEU members within Northern Ireland, led the non-cooperation. They voted a policy of non-cooperation with Northern Ireland's equivalent of Ofsted the Education and Training Inspectorate. Complete non-cooperation. That includes preparation for inspection, participating inspection, responding to the Education and Training Inspectorate communications, attending ETI workshops or training events, and members of ATL who are associate inspectors were instructed to cease to be involved in the inspection process. And this action has now held for 15 months. And in hundreds of schools, ETI inspections have not taken place of teaching and learning. The only things the ETI inspectors have been able to do is be held up in the principal's office and to talk to them about safeguarding. And more than that, when the chief inspector in Northern Ireland instructed her inspectors to report those teachers who refused to be inspected, they took out a grievance and they have now voted in their own industrial action not to do that. They are refusing to give the names of the teachers who will not be inspected. And that means in hundreds and hundreds of schools in Northern Ireland, inspections have not taken place. And do you know what? The quality of teaching and learning has not suffered one jot. So I salute our members in Northern Ireland. They've started a movement which has been taken up by the other unions and is now rock solid in refusing inspections. And do you know what the key issue is? The key issue is that the Education and Training Inspectorate can't be its own judge and jury when it comes to the final appeal on inspections. And you know, in England, now Ofsted have lost at the High Court, where Ofsted tried to argue that their own complaints procedure was so wonderful that if they placed the school in special measures, they were so careful about it, they could never be wrong. And the High Court threw that out. So we now have an inspectorate who can't enforce putting a school into special measures, which does lead you to question what they're there for, which I will do tomorrow. And last, I wanted to say something about ATL Future. Can you put your hands up if you're ATL Future? Well, you're just great. You're just great. You just cheer us up and, you know, fill us up with vim and vigour every year. And so welcome to conference. It's our last, as the ATL section, as we move forward into the really brave new world, exciting world of the National Education Union. And it is brave and it is exciting. It's sometimes terrifying, but it's the right thing to do. Because when we look at what's happened to education professionals, I've been General Secretary for 16 years, and can I say at the end of that 16 years that our working lives are better? I cannot. We need a stronger voice, we need a united voice, and the National Education Union, since its inception, has been doing that brilliantly. We're all over it like a rash, and we'll continue to be all over it like a rash. And I just want to say finally that your chair, President Niamh, is just great. She's a great president, an outstanding trade unionist, and a really lovely person. So you're in really good hands, and welcome to conference.
Thank you.